We are back. Happy Friday, guys. We have 11 game slate to talk about. My name is DK. I cover content for NFL, NBA, Daily Fantasy Sports, as well as for player prop stuff, like Prize Picks, Underdog, and Parlay Play. Parlay Play, they are the sponsor of this video. If you guys are not familiar with Parlay Play, it's a player prop site. They offer a lot of different sports. You can mix and match, and you can go up to 75x your money as well. So again, you're building slips of player props. If you do want to give it a try, click the link down below. Or you can use the code DKDFS. It'll give you a $100 deposit match bonus. If you do click that link and deposit, you do help support the channel. So greatly appreciate that. And if you guys are looking for more content for DFS or for prop stuff, you can check my Patreon link down below. I literally didn't have the energy to make a video last night. I had the worst beat of my gambling career. I've been gambling for 10 plus years now. Had Max Strus over fantasy score. He was over by 2.5 points. And then proceeded to go for 3 straight turnovers without getting another stat, and then got subbed out and went under. That prevented the full sweep at Underdog. I was 5-0 with him going for 3 straight turnovers, went to 4-1. I was just like, I don't even have the energy to tilt this. I'm going to take NyQuil and I'm just going to go to bed. That's all I'm mad at, because obviously I'm still a little bit under the weather. But yeah, just incredible, incredible beat. And it's just, again, adding to the proof, there's not one human that runs worse, right? Everyone knows that watches these videos for a while now. There's no one that runs worse than me. No one. Continue to put up with the horrific luck every single day. But yeah, as far as tonight goes, looking decent. In the early game, I had Claxton and I had Jaime Jaquez, and I have a full stack with, the Warriors stacked with SGA. I was very happy to see Lowell and Claxton was absolutely smashing. They close with Trent Watford. Okay. Claxton on pace for 40 plus. Trendon Watford, they close with. Again, right? It's just adding to the proof. There's not one human that runs worse than me. There's no one runs worse. No one. So yeah, looking good. We'll see how I finish, but we'll recap that in the next video. All right, let's just get into it. New York and Washington's first game here. For the Knicks, you got Barrett questionable and Quentin Grimes questionable. If RJ Barrett misses, we know what's going to happen. You're going to see Josh Hart in the starting lineup. He's going to play pretty big minutes. Now, if Quentin Grimes misses, my guess is it's either DiVincenzo or Quickly that move in the starting lineup. We'll see. I would assume it's one of those two. You might get like Miles McBride added to the rotation, but I would think it's one of those two to pick up a start if there's no Quentin Grimes. As far as the main two guys, Randle and Brunson, both look good. Randle, I think, is a slightly more optimal play, but both are playing huge minutes right now. Quickly, reasonable option if RJ Barrett plays. He looks better if Barrett and Grimes miss. Same with Josh Hart. Like, Josh Hart's probably someone I only play if RJ Barrett does not play. Mitch Robinson, he's one of many centers you can consider. The minutes have, you know, been a little bit up and down on him, but if he gets 30 plus minutes against the Wizards, I could see him having a ceiling game. I'm talking about the Wizards, a team that's, you know, just been very frustrating for DFS purposes this year. Minutes have not been amazing on these guys. We have seen a couple games where the starters have played mid-30s minutes. So like Kuzma, Poole, reasonable contrarian plays. That's really about it. Tyus Jones, again, the minutes have not been amazing on him. If he plays well, we've seen a couple games him play 30 plus minutes, but it's hard to trust right now. Koulibaly's played extremely well off the bench. He continues to play good minutes. The price, though, is increasing on him. I don't really think it's necessary to get to guys like Kispert, Gallinari, Shamet on this slate. I think we'll probably have better value overall. Milwaukee and Charlotte. So one of my strong stances in the Patreon stream the other day was I really like Dame Lillard at no ownership without Giannis. I just did not understand why 9K Dame without Giannis is getting no ownership, and he broke the slate. Also, hope you guys enjoyed. I did a YouTube stream for everyone, so hope you guys enjoyed that. We talked NBA, we talked NFL. Again, Claxton was a guy that was high on in the first game. Obviously, he would have had an amazing day if he came back in the fourth. But we gave away a prop there. Is over 2.5 blocks and steals. That hit, which was nice. But yeah, I'll try to do more of those in the future. But again, that's every single day. If you sign up for Patreon, you get that on patreon.com. But yeah, Giannis, if he misses, Dame Lillard, 9.8K would be a decent spend up. If Giannis is in, I think Dame is overpriced. Bobby Portis, 6.5K, would see more run if Giannis misses, but the price point has jumped on him. I mentioned Brooke Lopez is a viable Portis pivot last late. He smashed. Again, he had one of those games he won for seven blocks. Middleton, the minutes have not been amazing on him, but he'll play around 20 minutes, probably give you around 25 fantasy points. But guys like Beasley and Connaughton probably get a little bit more run if there's no Giannis. And then one of the fades that I was on was Andre Jackson. He got like 20 to 25% ownership. I said with him starting it, I thought it was most likely a spot start, and it was. He played 16 minutes and got 3 fantasy points. And that was in the range of outcomes the other day for a guy like Julian Champagne for the Spurs, right? But that fade, however, did not go well because, again, he went for 7 steals and blocks. Let's talk about Charlotte. So Charlotte, Hayward is questionable, and Brandon Miller is questionable. That's pretty important. Now, we do have Miles Bridges back. No idea what the role is going to be for Bridges. I think if he starts, I think you can feel comfortable with him playing at least mid-20s minutes. So we'll keep an eye on the news there with Bridges. But the guy that I want to talk about is obviously LaMelo Ball. You know, if there's no Hayward, there's no Miller, I mean, it's basically going to be him, team himself. He's playing huge minutes. I like the ceiling a lot on LaMelo Ball. I think Washington's priced about right, as is Mark Williams, whose production's up and down. I don't think it's necessary to get to Maladon with Bridges now back. Again, you saw some McGowans in the rotation. You saw some Ish Smith. It was just a gross Charlotte rotation. Don't think it's necessary to get to guys like McGowans or JT Thor on this one. Boston and Toronto. So Boston, Brown, and Porzingis are once again questionable. Al Horford is probable. Again, my take was I wanted to go heavy on the Celtics, and they all smashed without Brown and Porzingis. If those two are out once again, I really like Holiday. I really like Derek White. Jason Tatum would be a good spend-up. Al Horford would play good minutes. Sam Hauser played mid-30s minutes last game. You get a minutes bump for Pritchard. Everyone will look good here for Boston if those two are out. Now, if Brown and Porzingis are both in, then it's like no one really stands out for me on Boston. So the news on those two is going to change completely what I do with the Celtics team. For Toronto, you got OG doubtful, but Gary Trent is probable. So expect Gary Trent back. I think he'll probably pick up a start. Like, I think they'll go with Schroeder, Trent, Barnes, Siakam, and Poeltl. Now, no one really standing out for me on the Toronto side. I think Schroeder's reasonable. He did not close last game, though. He was on the bench. Poeltl and Precious Achiuwa are splitting center position. My boy Boucher, again, he'll see rotation minutes. He'll be productive, but probably lose a little bit of run here with Gary Trent back. So not much here for Toronto that I like. Philadelphia and Atlanta, I mean, they're just going to continue to listen. Embiid is questionable. I'm going to continue to expect him to play unless we are otherwise. So fully expect Embiid to play here. 11.4K. I think he's a good spend up if you can afford him. Maxey, 9.1K. The price dropped a little bit on him. He's still playing huge minutes. Fine option. Tobias and D'Anthony Melton in the mid-range, I think, are both pretty safe. I mean, you're seeing big minutes from Melton, right? 30, 30, 35, 34 minutes over the last couple games. Tobias Harris is playing high 30s minutes. So these guys are like safe plays. No, I'm not going to prioritize either, but they're going to play big minutes. And this was just DFS in a nutshell, man. DFS in a nutshell. Slam Robert Covington 2 slates ago, 16 minutes. The next game, nothing changed. 37 minutes for Robert Covington and a 30 bomb. It's a painful game that we play. I mean, you literally cannot make that up. 16 minutes to 37 minutes. I have no further comments to add on that matter. Atlanta. Nothing really standing out from Atlanta. Some of these guys are priced up from when Trae Young was out. Trae Young is now back. 9.2K for Trae is always fine for tournaments. DeJounte with Trae back is priced about right. The wings are priced about right. Bogdanović is a bit overpriced. You're going to see Capella and Okongwu split the center position against Embiid. Both have some foul risk. There's not a lot that I like here for Atlanta. Sacramento and San Antonio. So my boy Sabonis absolutely cooked AD last night. You love to see that. Almost a 70 bomb here from Sabonis. Good spot here. I think he's a good spend up at the top. I think De'Aaron Fox is still a solid option. Now Fox is at 9K, priced about right, but still against the Spurs, I'm fine with it. Guys like Murray and Herter, probably not going to get two of Fox back. Malik Monk is still seeing decent minutes on the bench, but I don't think it's necessary to go there. I mentioned JaVale McGee. I mentioned him the previous slate as a viable punt play. Well, in 9 minutes, he went for 19 fantasy points. He's going to play whatever Sabonis does not play, and he's, you know, about a fantasy point per minute player. So I don't think it's necessary on the slate, but did want to mention that. Talking about San Antonio. So Kelvin Johnson is probable. Trey Jones is doubtful. My guess for the starting lineup is Wembanyama, Kelvin Johnson, Zach Collins, Jeremy Sochan. I think you probably get Chimpenny in the starting lineup again. We'll see, but I think that's probably what they do. Pop in Wembanyama, 8.7K feels a little bit pricey, but still always like a ceiling in tournaments. Keldon and Vassell, or Vassell's out, I should say. Keldon, back. Keldon's a reasonable option. Zach Collins at 6.5K, should see around 30 minutes. Jeremy Soane at 5.8K, I think it's my favorite point per dollar play here for the Spurs. And then, yeah, Champagne probably gets the start, but you got to be a little bit careful here. Not going to get 7 steals and blocks again. Also, he's smashing garbage time. Before garbage time, these were his stats. Midway through the fourth quarter, he had 3 points, 3 rebounds, and 3 assists. So, he starts. Yes, you can consider him, but just be a little bit careful. I still think Isaac Branham and Osman would be solid pivots in tournaments at lower ownership. Let's talk about Detroit and Cleveland. For Detroit, no Durant, and now we got Bagley questionable. If Bagley's out, the Pistons do a couple different things. They could start James Wiseman. If Wiseman starts, he'd be probably the best point per dollar value on the slate, even though he's not a good real-life basketball player. He's a good FS, you know, good fantasy point-per-minute player. And then they could also start Isaiah Stewart at the 5 and just go a little bit smaller. So those two would benefit clearly if there's no Marvin Bagley. As far as the guards go, Cade and Ausar Thompson in the 7K range, both fine options. I think Ausar has a bit of a higher floor. Cade is the higher ceiling, in my opinion. Stewart, if Bagley plays, is just there. Again, he looks better if Bagley's out. These guards like Hayes and Sasser and Burks and Ivy, kind of hard for me to nail down like what they want to do with this rotation. So they're all secondary plays. And like I got to mention it, but Kevin Knox, for some reason, has been playing minutes. 24 and 29 minutes over the last couple games. I mean, at 4K, this Pistons team is short on wings. I think you got to have a little bit of interest in him, which is just weird in 2023 for me to recommend Kevin Knox as a viable play. Talk about Cleveland. So Mitchell and Garland both questionable. I mean, this could open up just massive valley here for the Cavs. If they're both out, you most likely get the starting lineup of LeVert, Strus, Dean Wade, Mobley, and Allen. And then I think LeVert would be the top overall play on the Cavs. If both those guards are out, he becomes the go-to guy, the primary playmaker. Max Strus would play massive minutes. You would probably see Mobley get a minutes uptick. Jared Allen, I'm not sure if he's still on a limit. He's been, you know, capped at around 30 minutes. Dean Wade would most likely start, but again, it's Dean Wade, right? 8 fantasy points in 33 minutes last game. You would get more on for Niang. And then I think you probably would get a guy like Craig Porter Jr. dusted off playing some backup point guard run. He could be even a little bit interesting at the Flatman price. So there'd be a lot to like here from Cleveland if both those guys are out. If they're both in, there's no standout place for me, but I think like all the main guys would be like solid options. Mitchell, Mobley, Garland, Jared Allen, Strus, all playable. All right, Orlando and Chicago. So for the Magic, no Carter Jr. and no Markel Fultz. So once again, you should get the starting lineup of Anthony Black in there with Jalen Suggs. Now, Anthony Black has not really been doing much with the starting lineup, but he is really, really cheap. Jalen Suggs and Cole Anthony are the guys that benefit here without Markel Fultz. I think both are good options in the 5K range. Paolo and Franz, solid options, you know, at their respective price points. I don't really have a strong lean with those two. You're going to get Bataze and Mo Wagner splitting the center position. Both should see low 20s minutes. I don't think it's necessary to get to either of them. And then you'll see some rotation minutes for Joe Ingles. You'll see some rotation minutes probably for Gary Harris. Yeah. Now for Chicago, DeMar DeRozan is questionable, but beat writers think he will be back with the team Friday. So with that being said, Chicago's a pretty unappealing team. You got a slight uptick in price for Vooch and Levine, and now you got DeRozan most likely back. There's just not a ton to like here from the Bulls. Russo also back too. This will probably be a team I'll most likely be staying away from unless DeRozan sits. If DeRozan sits, then I'll have a good amount of interest in Levine and Vooch, even though they let me down last slate. Denver and New Orleans, so no Jamal Murray. I mean, you know what I'm going to say about Jokic. If you can afford him, he looks amazing. This guy's averaging like 75 fantasy points a game. Yeah, he looks amazing. You can afford him. Michael Porter Jr., Aaron Gordon, both get a usage bump without Jamal Murray. They've also seen a minutes bump. They're both decent plays in the mid-range. Reggie Jackson, 5K, I think sees around 30 minutes. He's played pretty well in this starting lineup, so I think he's a fine play. KCP's role doesn't really change. Christian Brown, minutes have not been amazing, so probably can't do that. The bench unit has not been getting a ton of run, so I'll probably pass there. Let's talk about New Orleans. New Orleans, you got no CJ, so Dyson Daniels should start. I think Dyson Daniels is my preferred option here of the Pelicans. Like, he's my favorite option. Played 29 minutes last game. Massive blowout. 31 minutes the game before that. Massive blowout. So he's played well as the point guard. I think he plays low to mid-30s minutes. I do like Dyson Daniels here at the price point. Ingram and Zion, too, if this game can stay competitive, I like the ceiling on them. JV, you know, he'll be productive when he's out there, but the minutes have just not been great on him. Herb Jones feels priced right. Hawkins is a guy that just pisses me off beyond belief. I just never know what to do with him. He just, like, smashes off the bench last game out of nowhere. Like, I don't know. I literally don't know what to do with Jordan Hawkins. I don't know. And there's nothing else to mention here for New Orleans. Phoenix and Utah, so we were supposed to get the big three back last game, and then Beal gets ruled out. It's just like, the Suns team is just, they're just trolling. Now, Booker played 26 minutes last game. They said he's on a limit. I want to know if he's on a limit again. If Booker's not on a limit again, then I do like Devin Booker 10K. I would prefer 10K Booker to 9.7K KD if there's no limitations for Booker. Again, Beal is doubtful, but a lot of these guys are priced up. Like, Allen and Gordon are going to see a little bit more run with Beal out, but I don't think I can get to either of them with their respective price points. You'll probably see Goodwin play a little bit. I don't think it's necessary to go to guys like Bates, Diop, or anyone like that. My boy Nurkic kind of splitting minutes with Eubanks. Yeah, Suns another pretty unappealing team. I think Booker would be my preferred option if he's not on a limit. For Utah, no Walker Kessler. We kind of know what's happening. John Collins going to start at the five. He'll play low to mid-30s minutes. I think he's a solid option. Markkanen, 8.6K, been a little bit quiet, but always a guy with a ceiling. Jordan Clarkson, 6.8K. I mean, he's going to chuck when he's out there. 40-plus fantasy points the last three games, but he also has this in his range outcomes, right? He has sub-20 fantasy points in his range outcomes. So Clarkson's always a guy I like the ceiling on. Now, my boy Keontae George, the guy that I picked to win Rookie of the Year before the season started, is playing well in the starting lineup. And he finally had a decent shooting game on for 32 fantasy points. I think he's going to play around 30 minutes. I like him here at 5.4K. You know, he's going to have the ball in his hands a ton. He's, you know, a future piece of this Utah Jazz. So, yeah, I like Keontae. Don't think I can get to THT at that price point. Olynyk will play the backup five, but he's priced about right. Sexton, I mean, he'll be in the rotation. He played 28 minutes kind of out of nowhere last game. The last game was a bit of a blowout. If you told me that Sexton played 28 minutes again, I would love him at this price point, but I think most of the time he's going to be in the high teens in minutes. Agbaji should continue to start. Reasonable value play. Not a guy with a super high ceiling, but he has gone for 31 and 23 fantasy points over the last two games. Lakers and Blazers, so LeBron once again questionable. Now, I think he plays. He's played the last couple games that he's been listed as questionable, so I think LeBron plays. AD was horrific last game, going for 25 fantasy points. It was the LeBron show, but this is a great spot here. If both LeBron and AD play, I like the ceiling on both. Neither would be a must. If LeBron misses, then AD becomes a smash play, and then like everyone else looks way better. D'Lo and Reeves, Rui would start, Reddish and Prince probably see a minutes bump. Like everyone would look really good here if LeBron sits, but I do think LeBron James plays, which if he plays, no one really standing out here if the secondary plays. For Portland, the minutes have ticked down a little bit in the main guys, but there have been some blowouts. Sharp, Grant, Ayton, and Mays all look pretty similar to me. I think factoring in salary and position, Mays would probably be the guy I feel the best about. He's got shooting guard eligibility, and he is the cheapest of the four. But yeah, all four do have a ceiling. Kamara started last game and literally did absolutely nothing. You know, him and Thibel, low usage guys that will be in the rotation. You're going to see some Jabari Walker. You're going to see some Duop Reith. If you think the Lakers blow out Portland, then honestly, you could consider a guy like Duop Reith, who's playing the backup five. You know, if you do get that blowout game, yeah, he would get extended a bit. And then finally, Houston and the Clippers. My boy Şengün has played extremely well this year. The minutes have been solid on him in competitive games. This game, massive blowout. This game, massive blowout. 34 minutes here, 35 minutes here. You guys know I've been on Şengün since he's been a rookie, since he's coming to the league. And yeah, I like him here at 7.7K. If he plays mid-30s minutes, he is a bit underpriced. Van Fleet has also played huge minutes last couple games. 40 minutes in back-to-back games makes him firmly in play. Green seems priced about right. The minutes have ticked down on Jabari Smith. He's been struggling. But also you have guys like Tari Eason, my boy, Jayshon Tate in the rotation. Dylan Brooks will see some rotation minutes, obviously. Jeff Green has been playing some off the bench, so I don't think I can get to Jabari Smith, but my boy Tari Eason and Jayshon Tate, I think, are okay value plays. Both not bad point per minute. I'm expecting low 20s minutes for Jayshon Tate, probably around 20 minutes for Tari Eason. And finally, the Clippers, pretty unappealing team to talk about. I just have a tough time getting these guys. Paul George, Kawhi, Harden, Westbrook. If you feel really good about one of these guys, you know, kind of taking over, be my guest. You know, we've seen a couple of big games from Paul George, but I just kind of have a tough time clicking these guys. Zubac, without Mason Plumlee, has the opportunity to play more minutes, but, you know, we could see them try to go small. If you told me for sure that Zubac plays high 20s minutes, I would like him a good amount here. Norman Powell, Terrence Mann, they should see decent minutes off the bench. 4K for Powell, 3.8K for Terrence Mann. I actually think both are solid values. I think those two are probably my favorite plays in the Clippers, Powell and Mann. You're going to see rotation minutes for PJ Tucker. I'm not clicking PJ Tucker, though. You probably get a little bit of backup run here for Musa Diabate. Or, again, if they don't go to Diabate, they're just probably going to go small ball. So, that's the Clippers, and that's going to wrap it up for the video. So, as always, guys, if you do enjoy, make sure to like, subscribe, hit the notification bell. Talked about it, but we're getting very, very close to 20K. I think about 15 subscribers away. So, if you guys are not subscribed, please hit the subscribe button. And, I'll see you guys all in the next video.